the second time you've come since Mike and Jeff stopped racing. How is it for you to always come back here and see how much things changed, but then they still stay the same?
So yeah, this is the last time I was at the Loretta Lynn Dune Ranch here. I was with Cameron McAdoo, and you know, we had a really good run there. Had good Loretta Lynn, had a good Monster Cup where he took the win there, and we brought him into pro racing, you know, shortly thereafter. So we're here back again in 2020. It's been 4 years since I've been here, and it really hasn't changed a lot. There is definitely the vehicles are like bigger. They're getting bigger and bigger. All of the vehicles that are here. But in terms of like the atmosphere, the racing, and you know, all the hype, it's all the same that it's always been.
Okay, how did you guys find Luke? It sounds like you just saw him at a practice track a couple weeks ago and were impressed by his speed.
Yeah, so Luke Kalaitzian was, he was riding 125, you know, and I heard about this kid that had really good raw speed on a 125. And so I was kind of checking into it a little bit, and I saw that he actually borrowed a bike to go to Paula, borrowed a 450, and he beat all the kids there, you know, all the fast up-and-coming support kids. And so I was like, I was intrigued by it a little bit, and so kind of went and looked, and I saw that his, you know, his storyline was basically this big guy that can ride really hard and fast, but was too much for the bikes that he was riding, you know, that he was breaking 125. And the reason he was breaking 125 is because he was too fast for that level of bike. And so he was out riding at Glen Helen, and Kyle Lewis was letting him borrow an older 450, I think a 2015. And on that given day at Glen Helen, I was checking lap times, and at first I thought, man, I gotta have this wrong. So I actually called Chad, our engine builder, over and said, hey, can you just verify that I'm looking at this right? And so we checked back and forth, and his lap times were right on pace with Cooper Webb, Dean Wilson, and all of the better guys. He wasn't as fast as like Sexton, but he was on the same page as Webb and Wilson that day. And I was like, what the heck? This is like legit. So at that point, I asked him if he wanted to ride a 450 MCR bike. And he said he'd like to try one. So we went out for a couple of test sessions, and man, he was really good. And at that point I said, look, we want to help you, support you for the regional, for Loretta Lynn's, and take you to Loretta Lynn's on our bikes. And at that point he agreed. We put a little contract together, and here we are.
Were you scouting talent like purposely for Loretta's, or it just kind of fell into your lap?
No, trust me, the last thing I wanted to do this summer was go more racing, especially in light of, you know, obviously the circumstances of the world right now. It was the last thing on my list. But I felt that I was going to do not only myself, our manufacturer, and obviously for this kid, a huge disservice if I didn't like participate. You know what I'm saying? So I felt, you know, almost immediately like obligated to do this, because he was good enough. He was deserving. He's a grateful kid, and he had the level to be part of our team. So so here I am, and here he is, and we're going into tomorrow tied for first place in points. We're going up against the kid with the number one plate there, with the Star Yamaha.
LeBlanc.
Yeah, Matt LeBlanc, really good rider, really good race craft the kid has. So we're gonna have to race smart and fast to get this championship tomorrow, but I feel like the odds are in our favor tomorrow, so we're gonna try to win.
This pretty much looks like an engine that came right out of one of the bikes after Utah.
The bike that he's riding right now is basically Malcolm Stewart's race bike, less works parts.
Okay.
So no Honda HRC parts. I mean, as you see, there's kite hubs on the bike, there's stock brakes, you know, all of the special HRC parts I can't allow out of the factory program, you know what I'm saying? So in this particular case, he's on race tech suspension, which is really good. He's on kite hubs, and obviously we're running Nissan brakes, but we're none of the works parts are allowed at the amateur level. So I'm sure they're allowed in the rule book, but they're not allowed from Honda.
Yeah.
So from Honda, the works parts have to stay with the team pro riders.
And especially a guy like you that saw the protesting rules and all that other stuff, there's no way that Honda's going to go, take these sets of, full factory forks and everything out of the box.
Right. So basically he's riding with race tech suspension, production brakes, production hubs, but he has the full benefit of the team motor because it's allowed. And he's been riding really well. In the class that is the one that we're trying to win, the mod class, which is on a real bike, he's 2 for 2 for hole shots, and he's led the most laps in that class so far. So I feel like we're this close to getting it, and I think it's very possible.
What is it about him that impresses you so much? He does have a much different riding style. He's very aggressive, like you said. He hangs it out a lot. That's the one thing that I've been watching and noticing these last few days. But there's so much raw speed.
Yeah, the raw speed is what obviously attracted me. Like I said, when I first saw the lap time, I was expecting him to be about 4 seconds off of the real guys. And when I saw that he was like on the same lap time, I actually thought I was doing a mistake, I had called Chad over, Chad Braun, our engine guy, and said, just verify this for me. And it was legit, And so when you got a guy with raw speed like that, and obviously the second part of this, which is important to me, is that he's open to listening and learning, And a guy like that, you can really help and you can make them better.
This is the first time I've ever come to this race, but I've read about it my whole life. And you're such a major part of everything I've ever read. And so for it to be my first time and then see you down there in the staging area and you watching gates and watching how the track and everything goes, there is no one that knows this place like you. How is it, especially after all the years and all the stuff that you've done, to come here and still have all that knowledge? Because it all still does apply.
It's interesting that you say that about, like I said, we've come here, we've been very successful here. Mike has won 11 championships here, which is the most of any amateur. Obviously tied with James Stewart with 11, Adam Censorello with 11. But other than that, tied with those great riders for all-time wins. And it doesn't happen on accident. You got to put a lot of thought into what's going on. And Loretta Lynn's, between the track and the start and everything that goes on, is an ever-changing scenario. So, and even now, like this year, and like I said, I've been here for many years, I actually learned 2 or 3 things that I didn't know that I learned this year. So those are things that I'm now writing down to remember, for Loretta Lynn. So again, I learned 2 or 3 different things this year that I didn't know. So it's always evolving.
The big thing about how they run through the whole moto program, they run one through however many motos it is, and they just cycle through every few days, and it's not like you race twice a day in the same class or anything like that. You're in a lot of different track settings and weather settings and everything. What is it about that makes that track change so much? Because from little bikes to big bikes, it all comes together and makes this monster out there.
Yeah, there's a lot of elements that are going on, and the main thing is, if you want to be successful at Loretta Lynn's, you need to have your fingers on the pulse. It means you need to be paying attention. You can't just be out in the North 40 hanging out, drinking beers. You gotta be focused on what's going on with the track all day long, because it is ever changing. And if you're not paying attention, it could be the difference of 5 positions. So you just gotta stay on it.
All right, last question. Next week's the big one here. First ever pro race. Everybody is talking about how this is gonna be. I'm very interested to see. I think that guys are going to have to go slower than they think they are to really be fast here, because they could override the track pretty easily. But, you're the guy that knows this place. What do you think will happen come next Saturday?
I think that you're going to hear a lot of complaints next week about arm pump, especially 450 guys, because the track is small for a 450 rider. You know what I'm saying? So, I think that, I think for this track to work for the main class, which is the pro class, it needs to be longer. It needs to be, ripped a little more deeper. Obviously it's going to be challenging because it's going to be very, very hot here. you know. So I think honestly the rider that comes in here and is like maybe not overriding the motorcycle is kind of like riding maybe two numbers lower is the guy that might come out on top here.